Hello, welcome to Medicine with Dr. Moran. I'm Dr. Keith Moran. This week, a lot of information has come out from the approximate 10-day pause in the Johnson & Johnson Janssen COVID-19 vaccination. The FDA and CDC have now resumed vaccinations with this product. I wanted to review this information. Some of the slides that I will put up are directly from the CDC, and I have a link below in the description to the full slide set presentation if you wish to look at that. As this vaccine was being rolled out in the USA, reports of blood clots were noted, just like what has been seen for the AstraZeneca vaccine. This was not seen in any patient in the phase 3 Johnson & Johnson trial, but obviously we're getting into much larger numbers of people receiving the vaccine compared to what we saw in the phase 3 trial. About 8 million people in the US have received the vaccination now. It is the one-shot vaccine. Now, what's being described in very small numbers of vaccinated people is a syndrome of blood clots, which we call thrombosis, and it's associated with a low platelet count, which medically we call thrombocytopenia. They're calling this thrombosis and thrombocytopenia syndrome. There are other terms to describe it that you may have heard of, such as vaccine-induced immune thrombosis with thrombocytopenia. Here is some background information on thrombosis. Thrombosis can occur in veins as well as arteries, and it can cause heart attacks, strokes, and other problems. There are additional risk factors for blood clots, and there are a host of symptoms that people can get depending upon which artery or vein is blocked. We diagnose blood clots mainly through imaging tests, where we can see the blood clot on either ultrasound, CT, or MRI. Blood tests can often tell the extent of the damage. This slide explains what low platelets mean. The platelets are the blood cells in our circulation which stop bleeding by clumping together and form a plug in a blood vessel injury. For example, when you cut yourself and you're bleeding, the platelet plug is what occurs first. Now, dangerously low platelet counts can lead to serious spontaneous internal bleeding. In Europe, as well as other countries, they have found a link with the AstraZeneca vaccine to this particular syndrome. This slide is a release from the European Medicines Agency acknowledging this fact. They found 62 cases of blood clots in the veins of the brain and 24 cases of blood clots in the veins draining the intestines. 18 of these cases, unfortunately, were fatal. About 25 million people had received the vaccine, which gives an overall risk of 1 in 300,000. Obviously, this is a rare condition, and as I've highlighted at the bottom of this slide, the overall benefits of the vaccine and preventing COVID-19 outweigh the risks of side effects. It is, though, something for the individual person to consider if they're going to receive the AstraZeneca vaccine. As far as the Johnson & Johnson vaccine goes, there were reports of blood clots involving the veins which drain the brain, and a decision was made to put the vaccine on hold April 14th to get more information. This slide shows how blood is actually drained from your brain through veins which we call sinuses. The blood ultimately drains into both the left and right internal jugular veins, which then drain back into the heart. Blood clots in these veins of the brain are termed cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. These types of blood clots are quite rare, but they're quite significant and they can cause significant symptoms and illness and sometimes even death. They're very uncommon. I can tell you I've only seen 2 cases in my 30-year career as a consultant in internal medicine. These types of blood clots are not associated with low platelets usually. What we're seeing now, though, with Johnson & Johnson vaccination are not only blood clots in the cerebral veins, but the presence of low platelet counts as well. What was being found April 14th when the vaccine was put on pause is summarized on this slide from the CDC. At that time, they noted 6 reports of women in the 18 to 48 years of age, all with low platelets. At the time, this was 6 cases out of 6.8 million vaccinations. The rates of these venous blood clots in the brain appear to be about 3-fold greater than what you might expect as background rates in the general population. I make note that no reported cases of this clotting had been seen in 182 million vaccinations with Moderna or Pfizer. Now, the clinical features were similar to the features observed with the AstraZeneca vaccinations in Europe that I just talked about. The thing in common, of course, is that both vaccines use an incompetent adenoviral vector to deliver vaccine into the cells, whereas the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines are different. They have a lipid layer, or if you like, a coating of fat around their vaccine, which allows the vaccine to be delivered directly into cells. I will review how the vaccines work in this particular video. Subsequently, additional cases were noted after the Johnson & Johnson pause, and this slide details them. They're predominantly noted in the female population, with the vast majority in the 18 to 49 years of age range. This slide shows the age groups and rates. This next slide gives you a better idea of the ages. The patients had an average age of 37 and typically developed this syndrome 6 to 15 days after the vaccination. 12 cases were of clots inside the brain, with 3 cases having blood clots not within the brain, but in different blood vessels. Some of the 12 cases with clots inside the brain also had blood clots elsewhere. Now, how do you know if you have a blood clot? Well, this slide shows the typical symptoms as well as medical signs that someone might have this if they have a clot. A lot of the symptoms, as you can see, are quite nonspecific, such as a headache, chills, fever, nausea, fatigue, vomiting, and abdominal pain. Later on, there can be more specific symptoms, such as neck discomfort or stiffness, weakness on one side of the body, trouble with speech, difficulty with vision or double vision. Seizures and loss of consciousness can also occur. I wanted to show the locations of blood clots in these 15 people, because they may not just be in the veins of the brain. As I mentioned, 3 cases were not in that location, but were in other veins or arteries of the body. Many people had blood clots in more than one location, in fact. 11 of the 15 people had blood clots outside of the brain. This means, as physicians, we need to consider other locations for these clots. This slide shows treatments as well as outcomes. Of the 15 patients, 3 unfortunately died, 7 were still hospitalized at this time, with 4 in the ICU, and 5 were discharged from the hospital. I will go into diagnosis and treatment of this condition in another video. Now, in total, approximately 8 million J&J vaccinations were given, and we see 15 events where their blood clots associated with low platelets, which gives an overall risk of 1 in 500,000, or 1 in 500,000. We now understand more about this condition and its frequency. In a nutshell, both the AstraZeneca and Johnson & Johnson vaccines do induce an immune response which causes an antibody to be produced against platelets, ultimately leading to platelets to coming together and clump to cause blood clots. And because they're all clumping, they get consumed and you have less platelets in the rest of your body, giving you a low platelet count. Now, people are using different words to describe the syndrome. As I presented, the CDC is using the term thrombotic thrombocytopenic syndrome. But you'll hear other terms such as vaccine-induced immune prothrombotic thrombocytopenia to describe what's happening. It is important for doctors to consider blood clots in patients who present after vaccination and carry out the appropriate diagnostic tests and treatment, and of course, report these cases. There will continue to be safety surveillance and research on this condition as we go forward. Ultimately, it's a rare condition with the current rate estimated of 1 in 500,000 with respect to the J&J vaccine. The frequency, of course, may change slightly with time, but it will still be rare. It is on the order of someone getting struck by lightning and other infrequent risks. Risks, of course, using over-the-counter medications like aspirin, ibuprofen, even acetaminophen are going to be higher than this. Now, it's obviously not rare if you happen to be the person who gets it. It's something that people will want to consider when they're getting their vaccinations. Putting it in perspective, this is a tiny risk in comparison to the benefit of the vaccination in people at risk of an adverse event from COVID-19. Remember that blood clots are quite common in COVID-19 illness, with about 15% of people in the hospital getting a blood clot. We don't know the exact percentage of people who have COVID-19 who are not hospitalized who get blood clots, but for sure, it's almost certainly to be much higher than 1 in 500,000. I'm just trying to put things in perspective for you. Despite this, this remains a good vaccine. I have more information on the vaccine itself in this video. In that video, I review the results of the phase 3 trial and the effectiveness of the vaccine. Overall, I'm pleased to see resumption of vaccinations as the approximate 10-day pause meant that many people did not get vaccinated, which would have led to more COVID-19 infections that would not have happened if they had not had a pause. The pause in this risk, unfortunately, is going to make people think twice about receiving the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. It, of course, is a personal decision, which I know some of you are interested in, and so I've tried to present the best information we have so that people can make an informed decision and choose for themselves. Thanks for joining me today on Medicine with Dr. Moran. I'm Dr. Keith Moran. Thanks for watching my channel. Remember, get healthy and stay healthy.